you, Julian. Thank you for inviting me, and thank you for turning up for the talk. Before I demonstrate that there's been a considerable overlap between environmentalism and the history of the organic movement, I think it would be useful to define what organic means in this context. So in common usage, we probably think of it as involving some sort of commercial brand or food or drink with an ethical tinge, claimed as healthier because it doesn't contain additives and preservatives, or because the crops haven't been sprayed with pesticides and the soil in which they were grown hasn't been treated with chemical fertilizers. There certainly wouldn't be any GM ingredients. Cultivation methods would pay attention to environmental impact and aim to preserve biodiversity and beneficial insect and plant life. But organic cultivation isn't just a negative concept to be defined by what it doesn't involve. For instance, the ancient Romans had no chemical fertilizers or synthetic pesticides, but the large-scale estates of their empire, which ignored the rule of return of biological wastes to the soil and exhausted the fertility of North Africa, were far from being what we would call organic. Other cultures, particularly in the Far East, have provided examples of fertility maintenance which inspired 20th century pioneers of the organic movement. So clearly such contrasting approaches will have very different implications. So we'll have a look at some of the definitions of organic husbandry which have been offered over the past 60 or 70 years. For simplicity's sake, I'm not going to enter into the subtle distinctions between organic, sustainable, biological, holistic, etc., etc. It's best to focus on what they have in common. So the Wiltshire farmer and racehorse breeder, Friend Sykes, there he is, age 71, was one of the three main founders of the Soil Association. And he saw an organic farmer as someone who had faith in the power of the green plant to thrive, so long as the soil in which it grew was rich in humus. A soil like that was a living soil, granting the power of disease resistance to the plants grown in it, and, it was argued, to the animals and humans who consumed its products. For Jorian Jenks, who edited the Soil Association journal from its inception in 1946 until his death in 1963, the organic approach represented a continuous practical demonstration of workable alternatives to increasing dependence on artificial aids and to all the hazards that their use involves. Professor Lindsay Robb, an agricultural scientist of an international status, defined organic farming as good husbandry designed for optimum yields of highest quality food, free from anything detrimental to health and without impairing future productivity. This, of course, raises the question of what husbandry is. For Lindsay Robb, it was simply care of crops and livestock and keeping the land in good heart. He contrasted it with the philosophy of industrialism, which values quantity and speed of production and downplays the biological dimension to farming. A man called R.W. Widowson, who was the Soil Association's agricultural advisor during the 1980s, emphasized the holistic nature of organic farming, which recognized the vital importance of functioning ecosystems. Such systems are more than the sum of their parts and are unbalanced by inputs of fertilizers and pesticides. For Lawrence Woodward of the Organic Research Centre, there are significant differences between the main strands of the organic movement, but he identifies an essential core of agreement at its heart. I quote, "The conception of the farm as a living organism, tending towards a closed system in respect of nutrient flows, but responsive and adaptive to its environment. The understanding of soil fertility in terms of a living soil which has the capacity to influence and transmit health through the food chain to plants, animals, and humans. The idea that these linkages constitute a whole system within which there is a dynamic yet to be understood. A commitment to science and an insistence that while the above ideas challenge orthodox scientific thinking, they should be explored, developed, and eventually explained through appropriate scientific analysis. Lawrence Woodward also attaches considerable importance to the biological philosophy of J.C. Smuts and his theory of holism. Organic farming involves an approach which sees natural objects as wholes, which are more than the sum of their parts. They cannot be understood in isolation from their surroundings, which they are influenced by and in turn influence. So, such an approach is the antithesis of the agribusiness model. It gives primacy to ecological over purely economic values and to quality over quantity. It's human scale, not industrial scale. It adopts a systems approach and sees nature as a wheel of life seeking to work in harmony with this cycle. So here's an image of the wheel of life, the wheel of health. It aims to create a virtuous circle of health and productivity. In contrast, the organic movement would argue with agribusiness, which creates a vicious circle of soil erosion, plant weakness, and animal ill health, requiring ever more complex forms of treatment. So, although the organic movement has been working hard for 30 years or more to ensure its products are a permanent fixture of established retail arrangements, the philosophy of the organic movement has implications which are at odds with the existing social system. There are at present some close links between the organic movement and transition towns, as I'm sure you know, which looks to create more self-sufficient and less oil-dependent communities. Now, historically, the early organic movement was concerned about what it saw as an imbalance in the United Kingdom between rural and urban, and the decline of rural life and society. It wanted to see less dependence on international trade and a greater degree of national self-sufficiency in food production. It supported the smaller family farm and wished to encourage a sense of the region. The body of the nation had to be created from a variety of healthy local cells. This is the image, the metaphor. A thriving national culture must grow from the ground up, to use a favourite organic phrase. And here we see Jorian Jenks's book of that title from 1950. An introduction by the topographer H.J. Massingham. So it should grow from the ground up, not be imposed top down by a uniform state. So the organic movement tended to oppose state socialism. It favoured the local and the traditional, the craftsman and the small producer. Certain similarities can be found with a later phase of the movement. E.F. Schumacher in 1971 became president of the Soil Association. He'd actually been a member for 20 years already. And 2 years later, his book Small is Beautiful was published. Its message was given an enormous boost by the events of the winter of 1973-74, when we had the oil crisis, which one or two people might remember. Schumacher was already warning more than 40 years ago of the risks run by an agricultural and transportation system which depended on a finite and insecure supply of oil. So we might see in Schumacher a link between the early movement with its support for small farmers and small-scale technology and contemporary developments like farmers' markets and transition towns. So we'll return to Schumacher later on. So there's always been to the organic movement a wider perspective than simply agricultural. A vision of a society which is decentralised, less concerned with international trade, less dependent on complex and vulnerable technological and transport systems, and more concerned with production and craftsmanship than with consumerism and the mass media. So it should be clear from this, I hope, that environmental concerns are closely entwined with the ideas of the organic movement. So I'll try to bring some of these threads together in a very rapid survey of its history. Going back 150 years to the novel by Victor Hugo, Les Misérables, Hugo drew attention to what is the organic movement's most central concern when he reflected on the Parisian sewage system and its waste of fertility. Excrement, which could have been composted Oriental fashion and used on the land, was instead being flushed into the river to pollute the water. This was a flouting of what the organic movement calls the rule of return, and was an example of the neglect of agriculture in favour of the urban population. Well, this theme was taken up and developed at much greater length in an English book, first published in 1893. This is Rural Hygiene by a noted medical scientist, Dr. George Vivian Poor. Poor admired the composting methods of the Chinese and believed that the earth was the only permanent and reliable source of wealth in any country. The waste of supposedly worthless, but in fact most valuable materials, which occurred in London, Paris, and other conurbations, meant that such places were a threat to the countryside. Agricultural interests had been sacrificed to those of manufacturers who polluted watercourses and allowed chemicals to find their way into town sewage, destroying its manurial value. Another admirer of Oriental methods was an American soil scientist called Franklin King, who actually resigned from his post of chief of the Division of Soil Management at the United States Department of Agriculture in order to visit China, Japan, and Korea. The record of his travels, which were undertaken in 1907, was published as Farmers of 40 Centuries in 1911. And there you have some photos, which he took of the fertility of Oriental agriculture. This is a typical set of photos from his book, demonstrating the way in which the land in the Far East was intensively used for cultivation. The book's title was a shaft aimed at progressive orthodoxy. Can there be anything wrong, King was implying, with methods which had proved sustainable for over 4,000 years? America's treatment of its soils was inefficient in comparison, he believed. He wrote, "Complete a square on the lines drawn from Chicago southward to the Gulf of Mexico and westward across Kansas, and there will be enclosed an area greater than the cultivated fields of China, Korea, and Japan, from which five times our present population are fed." King actually died almost immediately after writing this book. But for Dr. Bailey, who provided a preface to it, King's work was a warning to the USA that it was in danger of forgetting. It's all right. King's work was seen as a warning to the USA that it was in danger of forgetting that the first condition of farming is to maintain fertility. The Americans prided themselves on their agricultural wealth, said Bailey, but he pointed out that this was great simply because the soils were fertile and new. American farming was actually wasteful. It tolerated degrees of field erosion in the southern states which would never have been tolerated in the Far East. Things had been too easy for the farmers who had not yet needed to learn to farm well. So, not much more than 20 years after Bailey expressed these views, soil erosion, the Dust Bowl as we know it, in the Midwest had become a national crisis. This is from a book called The Rape of the Earth by G.V. Jackson Orrow White. It's published in 1939. By the end of the 1930s, soil erosion was featuring as a major concern of the emerging organic movement in Britain. The pioneers of the movement were students of the Earth's surface. Not in any detached way, the state of the few inches of fertile topsoil, they believed, was literally a matter of life and death. On that surface and its fertility depended humanity's survival, health, and social stability. In 1938, the publication of Famine in England by Viscount Lymington, which dealt, among other issues, with the spectre of soil erosion, drew together several leading figures in the organic movement to discuss the relationship between soil and health. And I think if you were really looking for one year in which the organic movement started to come together, probably 1938 is the year to go for. And this was a crucial book. In the following year, Faber and Faber published The Rape of the Earth by Jackson White, a study of worldwide soil erosion, which drew attention to the extent of soil loss in the nations of the British Empire. They have an example of soil erosion in India. And as you may well know, in 1940, there was the film of The Grapes of Wrath, released, bringing home with a powerful visual impact the destructive effects of mechanized agriculture on both the soil and the social fabric of the Midwestern states. 1940 was also the year that the East Kent landowner Lord Northbourne advised people to look to the land in one of the key texts of the early organic movement. There he is, looking fairly saturnine, I would say, but it was an important book, one which was very influential. We can also note the work of some other figures who might be described as organic environmentalists in the interwar period, who came to be major figures in the organic movement. One important cause of soil erosion was deforestation. And as early as 1922, a forester called Richard St. Barbe Baker had established in East Africa the Men of the Trees organization in order to protect and plant trees. Several leading organic pioneers became members, and Baker himself was a founder member of the Soil Association. And there he is pretending to be Lawrence of Arabia. And here is an example of North African landscape which he helped to reforest over a period of 25 years. In this country, there was the topographer H.J. Massingham, who by the late 1930s was writing books on English regions for the Batsford Company, celebrating England's landscape, craftsmanship, and vernacular architecture. It's the cover of one of his best-known books. And Massingham also would become a founder member of the Soil Association. And there was the agronomist and plant breeder R.G. Stapledon, Sir George Stapledon, who in 1935 published a major study of land use and land potential in Britain, The Land, Now and Tomorrow. here we see Stapledon addressing a meeting during what was called the Plough Up campaign early in World War II. Plough up grassland to grow more crops. And we have him in a more domestic setting as he realises as he's forgotten to bring out the biscuits. Stapledon was an authority on grassland who was consulted by American agriculturalists and soil engineers engaged in trying to fight the spread of the Dust Bowl. He strongly influenced a number of people in the early organic movement, but he wasn't completely committed to it. He retained a scientist's scepticism about it. He's an interesting figure who had a foot in both camps, orthodox and organic agriculture. He also took a less traditionalist approach to rural society than some leading lights in the organic movement did. He wanted to see a working countryside, well populated with plenty of light industry. He was based in Aberystwyth for much of his career, and he felt strongly about the need for viable hill farming and for having well populated uplands. And he ended his career not all that far from here at the Grassland Research Institute at Drayton in Warwickshire. There are two other major figures to mention. Sir Albert Howard, the agricultural botanist, and the nutritionist Sir Robert, Sir Robert McCarrison. Both men spent many years in India. Both admired Indian agriculture, and both came to identify humus-rich soil as the probable key to health. So we've got an example of the scientific composting which Howard undertook in India in the 1920s. And there is McCarrison. Now, McCarrison worked with the Hunza people on the northwest frontier of India, and he attributed their remarkable health, stamina, and physique in large part to their methods of food production, which scrupulously observed the rule of return. Now, here we have a picture of one of the men of Hunza with a splendid moustache. Howard drew similar conclusions about the value of the rule of return in relation to the health of crops and animals, and he enjoyed considerable success in replenishing the fertility of worn soils through application of scientific composting methods. You've seen that one already. So by the beginning of World War II, we've got the nascent organic movement as, in effect, an environmentalist group. Its leading figures were students of the Earth's thin covering of topsoil. They recognised the importance of forest and woodland for the maintenance of soil stability and the prevention of flooding. They related the demands of international trade to environmental degradation and soil erosion in countries which were producing crops for export. We might say, in fact, that they were early critics of globalisation. They considered that British society was unbalanced, having an insufficient proportion of people involved in rural activities, and with the mainly urban population increasingly reliant on other nations for food. And as the war went on, they became ever more critical of the direction which agriculture was taking, with its rapid mechanisation and reliance on artificial fertilisers. What effect would such methods have on the landscape and on the soils which were being deprived of biological wastes? And what effects might the food produced by these methods have on the animals and the humans who consumed them? All these concerns were drawn together by Eve Balfour in her book, The Living Soil, 1943. And there is Lady Eve on her Suffolk farm between the walls, struggling with the realities of soil while the man looks on and offers intellectual advice. The publication of Balfour's book has to be seen in the context of the previous year's Beveridge report on social security, of discussion of a possible national health service, and of a widespread desire for post-war social reconstruction. There was also a determination that farmers, who were doing so much to ensure national survival, were not betrayed again as they had been so soon after the 1914-18 war. The title of Balfour's book invokes the idea of a virtuous circle of health creation to which the Earth's surface holds the key. Return of biological wastes to the soil creates humus. A humus-rich soil absorbs moisture and reduces both flooding and erosion. Humus encourages fertility without the application of chemicals, which upset soil ecology and harm the earthworm population. Crops grown in humus-rich soil have greater powers of disease resistance, and the animals and humans who eat them will enjoy positive health, not just mere absence of illness. This was the organic hypothesis, and Eve Balfour considered it important enough in its implications to be worth investigating. Now, I mentioned earlier that the farmer Fred Sykes was one of the three founders of the Soil Association. Eve Balfour was another, and the third was someone who was unusual in that his sphere of activity was urban rather than rural. This was Dr. George Scott Williamson, who, with his partner Dr. Innes Pierce, established the Pioneer Health Centre in Peckham, South London. So there it's Scott Williamson. Interestingly, he's smoking. Someone, he was an advocate of health. And there is the modernistic Pioneer Health Centre building, designed by the architect Sir Owen Williams, whose previous commission had been the Boots building in Nottingham. This building still stands. It's now being converted into a block of exclusive luxury flats and it's a gated community now. So Scott Williamson and Pierce knew McCarrison well, and they were interested in investigating the factors which made for health. At Peckham, they created a social and medical centre which served, in a sense, as a laboratory for these investigations. So we can apply this organic metaphor to their vision of society, families as cells of the greatest social organism. It was apparent that the work at Peckham had wider implications than the health of individuals, since families couldn't enjoy health without an environment which enabled them to fulfil their creative capacities and provided them with good housing and good food. The Pioneer Health Centre was supplied with organically grown produce from a farm at Bromley Common in Kent. And there we see mothers helping out at the home farm during the war. One of the doctors involved with the centre, Kenneth Barlow, attempted to create an estate on the outskirts of Coventry in the 1940s, which expanded the idea of Peckham and would have had its own farm. This was in fact very close to here at Binley and Brandon Woods, that area. So this is Barlow looking rather happier on his tractor than Eve Balfour does on hers. He was stymied by certain local councillors in the end. But the project might be seen in its conception as akin to the garden cities of Ebenezer Howard, seeking to bring urban and rural closer together. And it's worth noting that Barlow, as a young man, had been secretary to the biologist and town planner Sir Patrick Geddes. You've got here a picture from Geddes's book on cities in evolution, looking at the urban sprawl which was spreading across Britain. So, I hope this has so far convinced you that the organic movement is about more than just the promotion of organic products in supermarkets. Philosophically speaking, the organic movement conceived life in biological rather than mechanistic terms. Even agriculture, which should have recognised the organic biological nature of life, was becoming mechanised and industrial, regarding the soil as an inert substance whose productivity could be indefinitely increased through the application of chemical fertilisers. Now, Viscount Lymington, his book cover we saw earlier, had caught a glimpse of the future when he was a member of a wartime British mission to study farm buildings in North America. In California, he saw Mexicans toiling at vast conveyor belts, large herds of cows mechanically milked and fed, and the few remaining labourers working in conditions not far from slavery. In some of these dairies, he wrote, there resided a white-robed scientist, a high priest among the test tubes, ever alert to suppress disease. Was this the way that British agriculture would follow? Certainly it seemed likely, and if that came to be, what effect would this have on Britain's rural life and environment? Well, late in 1945, Lymington was present at what was termed an encounter between representatives of agriculture, or husbandry, and of agri-industry, or agribusiness as we'd now call it. Now, this was organised by a body called the Council for the Church and Countryside, which was really a front organisation for the organic movement. Supporters of organic husbandry debated with representatives of a mechanised approach to agricultural production. Well, as we know, it was the mechanistic approach which won, hands down. Efficiency, that being defined as the greatest possible output per man, was the chief concern of the 1947 Agriculture Act, which shaped British farming for the next quarter of a century, with far-reaching implications for rural society and for the environment. So here we have an advertisement from the Westminster Bank Limited. This is from 1946. Farmers' progress, the farm of the future. Much of our agricultural inheritance, which was more picturesque than effective, will have disappeared to be replaced by modern structures designed to fit a purpose, in the attainment of which they achieve their own beauty. Not like all that picturesque stuff that Massingham was keen on. Farming practices whose only merit lay in their antiquity will be discarded. The farmhouse hoard of cash and notes for business transactions will give place to a banking account, an account which the Westminster Bank is unusually well qualified to handle, etc., etc. I mean, there's a huge amount of this stuff from the same book on post-war agriculture. So efficiency meant larger farms, fewer workers, according to this view. By around 1970, two authorities on agriculture, J.G.S. Donaldson and his wife Frances Donaldson, regarded small farms actually as a problem, posing a threat to the balance of the farming industry. Economically, they said, only larger farms were viable. The Donaldsons accepted that smaller farms were more productive per acre than large ones, and that they were environmentally beneficial. But such considerations were irrelevant to a purely economic approach. In 2000, the economist Sean Rickard at the Cranfield School, yes, I know, of management was arguing that the process of size increase must be pushed still further. He wanted to see, I quote, a hollowed out industry, which is an extraordinary phrase when you think about it. So for Rickard, economics trumps both social and environmental considerations. The chief means of reducing the labour force was mechanisation, but another major effect of mechanisation has been its impact on the landscape. In 1980, Marion Shoard published her influential polemic, The Theft of the Countryside, and identified mechanisation as a primary cause of the removal of landscape features. These photos were taken 6 months apart in West Sussex, before and after. Machines need a clean sweep in which to turn, and farmers need their expensive machinery driven as quickly as possible around unencumbered fields to consume as few man-hours as possible. Earth-moving equipment has obliterated many so-called obstructions in preparing the way for machines to plough and harvest on a mass production scale, while the machines themselves require new buildings to house them and new roads on which to travel. Farmers were able to provide these facilities for themselves up to a considerable size without planning permission. And another important factor was the system of minimum price levels guaranteed under the Common Agricultural Policy, which made it profitable for farmers to plough up almost any kind of uncultivated land to increase their output. The organic movement has consistently opposed large-scale industrial methods of farming, not just for agricultural reasons or on grounds of health. One of the early movement's most tenacious critics, an agricultural chemist called Donald Hopkins, observed in 1945 that organic husbandry tended to appeal to those of artistic leanings. Now, much of the organic critique of industrial agriculture is based on aesthetic valuation, the ugliness of agricultural methods and of the landscape and products they result in, contrasted with the beauty that mixed farming or permaculture can create, or the beauty of animals which are allowed to live freely, or the attractiveness of the foods produced by artisan specialists. In the organic movement's view, industrial agriculture results in featureless monoculture, the destruction of copses and hedgerows, the erection of soulless buildings, and the horrors of factory farming. The varied regional cultures of rural life and work disappear, leaving the sterile, picturesque perfection of towns and villages fit only for the wealthy to colonise. Now, the organic movement has been so complex that it's very difficult to identify beliefs which would be acceptable to all of its supporters. In my book, The Development of the Organic Network, I identify two ideas as what might be termed the bedrock philosophy of the movement. I suggest that their recognition of the Earth's limits and the interconnectedness of natural entities in systems, that is, holism or ecology. The appearance of Rachel Carson's book Silent Spring in 1963 is generally taken as the starting point of British environmentalism, but from what I've said, I hope it would be clear that awareness of environmental problems was present many years earlier in the development of the organic movement. In the first essay of the first issue of the Soil Association's journal Mother Earth, Eve Balfour urged that, I quote, "A steady increase in our knowledge and understanding of nature's biological laws and the significance of the complex interplay between living organisms must be brought about. The investigation of this interplay has its own science called ecology." In the spring 1948 issue of the journal, its editor, Dorian Jenks, related the principles of ecology to the practice of mixed husbandry, arguing that the more the farm is built around the machine, the less likely it is to conform to a balanced ecological pattern. Yet such a pattern is indispensable as a basis for biological efficiency. Ecology can confirm and enrich traditional practice. The same issue carried an article by Richard St. Barbe Baker on applied ecology in forestry. Baker, as I mentioned earlier, founded the Men of the Trees, and in the summer school of this organisation in 1947, Philip Merrey, another former disciple of Patrick Geddes, gave a talk on the ecological basis of civilization. Not being able to find many pictures of Merrey, but this is the cover of a collection of essays. I don't know how accurate that is, a picture of him. But he was certainly a learned man, so it looks roughly right. But this talk on the ecological basis of civilization, I say it goes back to 1947, that's 25 years ahead of The Ecologist. It's a very interesting lecture. And just one other reference to underline this point. In 1951, Mother Earth published a long article entitled Agricultural Ecology as a Branch of Science. And this article is particularly interesting because its author, Dr. Frank Fraser Darling, made a considerable impact with his Reith lectures in 1969, Wilderness and Plenty. And this was a considerable influence on a younger generation of environmentalists. The organic pioneers had been promoting his work nearly 20 years earlier. And here we have a cover of a book he wrote in the late 1940s for the Collins New Naturalist series, in which he analyses the ecology of this region of Scotland. He defined ecology as the science of causes and consequences, though he wondered whether it were not really an attitude of mind, the attitude of someone who could predict where agricultural practices were likely to lead if they interfered with the natural order. And we can also mention here the geographer Dudley Stamp, whose work the Soil Association similarly valued. And Stamp, in fact, gave an Albert Howard Memorial Lecture in 1954 on the topic of Britain's underdeveloped lands. Here is an illustration from his book Man and the Land. This is the London suburb of Edgware, demonstrating the spread of urbanisation during a period of only 20 years between the late 1920s and late 1940s, land which was being overdeveloped. Now, people like Mere weren't opposed to the achievements of technology. And Mere's concern was how the disruptive mechanical power of 20th century technology impacted upon ecological systems. He admired projects such as the work of the Tennessee Valley Authority in America, where technology was used to reinforce and protect ecological systems rather than destroy them. Something seems to have gone wrong here. Something has disappeared. Never mind. I was going to show pictures from a book by Julian Huxley on the Tennessee Valley Authority. It seems to have gone missing. So, after the impact of Silent Spring, the Soil Association tried to position itself, not very successfully actually, in the vanguard of the ecology movement, because it was aware that it actually had a strong track record in that area. In 1964, Robert Waller became editor of its journal, with Michael Allaby as his assistant. There's Robert Waller. Waller had been was Stapledon's biographer, and he edited a manuscript which Stapledon had left unfinished at his death, which was published in 1964 under the title Human Ecology. It was Waller and Allaby who discovered that E.F. Schumacher, who'd been writing on the environment for the Observer newspaper, was a Soil Association member. He belonged ever since 1951. They persuaded him to play a more prominent part in the association's affairs, with the result that he became its president in 1971, 2 years before he hit the jackpot with Small is Beautiful. There is the biography of him by his daughter. Now, he'd been chief economist at the National Coal Board, but was deeply interested in agriculture. During the war, he'd worked for a time as a farm labourer. He was German, and so he was interned for a time as an enemy alien. And this experience set him thinking about the direction that agriculture should take when the war ended. At that time, he favoured the solutions of the progressive agriculturalists. He rejected the idea of small holdings, and he favoured large-scale state intervention, with perhaps a third of agricultural land being nationalised. His feeling for the land, discovered during his wartime work, expressed itself in a love of gardening when he settled in Surrey in 1950. He joined the Soil Association for the advice on gardening which it offered, but his eyes were open to a new way of thinking. He didn't contribute to the journal Mother Earth until the mid-1960s, but by the time he did contribute, his thought had come a long way from his views of 20 years earlier. He was now a wholehearted advocate of the organic view that productivity should be measured by output per acre, not per man. For feeding the world, only the former criterion was relevant. In other words, you produce as much as possible from the land you've got. Large-scale, capital-intensive, labour-saving techniques disadvantaged the poor, whereas human-scale technology could give them independence. One aspect of his outlook which identified it closely with the organic movement was his sense of the limits to human activity imposed by the finitude of certain natural resources. He described modern humanity as destroying the irreplaceable capital without which nothing can be done. Schumacher's observations on fuel consumption in particular were far-sighted, anticipating the contemporary organic movement's interest in peak oil. But he based the case for organic agriculture on the environmental and social damage which industrial agriculture brought in its wake. In his view, agriculture's second task after producing food was to humanize and ennoble man's wider habitat. It could fulfill this function only by obeying the rule of return through diversified cultivation and through decentralizing its distribution system. Organic husbandry was therefore an important means whereby the environment could become beautiful and fruitful once more. Today, we'd probably be inclined to connect the question of dependence on non-renewable resources to the question of distance. Our food production, distribution, and imports rely on the continued supply of oil. Given the situation in the Middle East and North Africa, these questions would take us straight into the realm of geopolitics. The other leading green guru of the 70s was John Seymour, the apostle of self-sufficiency. There he is looking rather furtive. He was another Soil Association member who was active in the West Wales group, again, very influential. He recounted the story of his journey towards self-sufficiency in a book called The Fat of the Land, which was published in 1961. And this was praised by Jorian Jenks for its demonstration that to be a part of the peasant economy gave independence from the money economy. The oil crisis of 73-74 reinforced this message. So the ideal of what Jenks termed the good life became a demanding but practical response to the threat of a collapsing infrastructure. And Seymour wrote a novel in the mid-70s called Retrieved from the Future. And it wasn't published until 1996. But it appears to have been a response to the 1973 oil crisis. And it imagines what would happen to Britain's civil and political structure if the oil supply were to be interrupted. As Seymour presented the situation as a battle between two cultures, two different kinds of economy. On the one hand, the oil-consuming city-centred people, and on the other, the peasantry. The city people were unbeatable as long as the oil held out, but if it dried up, they would wither away. So the nation's stability and survival would depend on the establishment of a peasantry rather than a technocracy, and its roots would be regional. So 50 years after this encounter between agriculture and agri-industry, husbandry and economic efficiency, we find still strong in the organic movement its belief in the smaller scale farmer, the craftsman, and the importance of the local region. So I'm going to finish just by referring to another of John Seymour's books, which is relevant to the theme. In his later years, he travelled very widely. And in the mid-1980s, in the company of someone called Herbert Girardet, he made a TV series for the BBC called Far From Paradise, the story of human impact on the environment. And this looked at post-1945 developments in the light of what had happened to ancient civilizations which had destroyed their forests and soils. The book of the series contained the same sort of photographic evidence which Jackson White's had provided in The Rape of the Earth 50 years earlier. Gully erosion, forest turning to desert, dust storms, as well as more contemporary images of crop spraying, burning hedges, and the abstract landscape patterns of industrial farming. So you see the top is gully erosion in Kenya, and below sheet erosion in Idaho. where the soil has gone down to the bedrock. The answer to evils like this was the organic alternative, with its attention to many factors: the rate of unemployment and crime in the cities, the probable oil and natural gas reserves of the planet, the probable effects on soil degradation, erosion, disease, and soil biology. In short, only the organic perspective of human ecology was adequate for assessing the impact of a particular agricultural technique. Girardet's final contribution to the book was an essay called The Amplification of Man, and it provides an interesting link with an essay which Philip Meret had written at the end of the war, A Civilization of Techniques, in which Meret had expressed a cautious optimism that technology could in principle help restore root and branch the natural terrestrial organism upon which it is grafted. More than 40 years later, Girardet showed that this optimism had proved unfounded, demonstrating that the effects of amplified man during the intervening period had been to turn land covered with lush vegetation into a wasteland. The results of powerful technology were there for all to see. Progressive scientists could no longer afford to ignore the findings of ecology, which Girardet defined as the science of planetary housekeeping. There was no real conflict between ecology and economics. The former was simply long-term economy, since running down planetary resources was bad economics. The effects were suicidal. As Seymour wrote in the book's opening essay, mankind was destroying the community of which he was a part, the living community of the Earth. So, this has been a very hasty survey of some of these themes, but I hope that this might convince you that the history of the organic movement does show that it has made a contribution to the development of environmentalism.